So far in these videos, we've been discussing the MotionBuilder API in sort of a low-level overview. But in addition to just telling you what the API can do, I'd like to steer us toward a broader discussion of how to use it in practice to write good code. Whether you're writing scripts or designing software, one of the most fundamental concepts is decomposition, or factoring. This is the idea that you can solve complicated problems by breaking them down into smaller pieces. Pretty early on, as soon as you start writing functions, you realize how useful this idea is. If you're writing a script that does the same non-trivial series of operations at different times, you might initially have some duplicated code. By refactoring this series of operations into its own function, you can encapsulate whatever it does in a way that's reusable. This also begins to touch on another very important concept, abstraction. By creating this function, we've reduced whatever complex steps are involved to a black box with some reliable set of inputs, outputs, and side effects. Once we've defined what our function does, implemented that behavior, and ensured that it works as expected, we no longer have to concern ourselves with how it gets the job done. So to come back to MotionBuilder, let's say that we're writing a script, and as part of our script we want to create a group containing all the models that are currently selected. Here's one way we could do that. We make a group, we get a list of selected models, and then we iterate over that list, adding each model to the new group. Now let's see how we might improve this script with the addition of a couple of utility functions. First, we'll write a convenience function that just wraps a call to fbGetSelectedModels so that we can simply have a list of models returned to us. Next, we'll write a function that creates an FB group while initializing it from a list at the same time. It may be slightly alarming to you that our new and improved script is already longer than the original, despite it not even doing anything just yet. But here's the point. We can already forget about how these two functions are implemented. Since we know that these functions are available to us, and since we trust that they work, the main body of our script is now as simple as this. This is a slightly contrived example, to be sure, but I think it illustrates the benefits of this approach. In the original script, we have a comment, create a group from the selected models, and then a dense bunch of statements that carries out that intention. Notice now that even if we omit the comment, the new script describes the same purpose. From a quick glance, we can see that this line of code creates a group, which represents the initial selection, and that it uses the set of selected models in its creation. Not only is our code self-documenting, it's also much more expressive. We're suddenly able to operate on a higher level of abstraction, where each statement solves a larger part of the problem than before. If you've written more than a few scripts in your time, then this probably isn't a new idea for you. It's sort of a given that you should break a large problem into smaller functions. But I want to make a distinction here. There's breaking a specific problem into more manageable pieces, and then there's writing general-purpose utility code that can be applied to many different problems. This is what you might call library code. Creating a library gives us something that's separate from any particular script. It gives us a persistent code base that we can maintain over a long period of time, and that makes it easier to write new scripts. Going back to our original example, let's say that we have two completely separate scripts, and we want to use our create group function in both of them. Without a library, we'd have to copy and paste that function from one script to another, but we'd prefer to avoid duplicating code. If we had a Python module that contained our custom-written extensions, we could simply import that module to get access to our function. Here's how that might look. So, let's create a module. First, we need a place for our module to live on the file system. For the sake of example, I'm just going to create a directory on my C drive called Python modules. Next, we need to add this directory to the path so that MotionBuilder's Python interpreter knows to look there for modules. There are more permanent ways of doing this, but for now we can do it at runtime by adding our directory to sys.path. Now that we have that out of the way, let's create a package to serve as our Python module. In basic terms, a module is just a Python file, and a package is a module that can contain other modules. We can create a package by making a directory and adding a file called init.py. Now we have a module that we can import by name from MotionBuilder. For the sake of brevity, I'm going to import it under the alias MB. Now we can access our module, which at the moment is empty. So let's add something to it. This is a good time to start working with an external IDE. A lot of people use Eclipse or PyCharm, but I'm just going to use my favorite text editor, which is Sublime Text. Let's start with our two functions, one that lists the selected models, and one that creates and populates a new group. Since our package could potentially get pretty big, it'd be a good idea to organize it into smaller modules. So I'm going to create two submodules. Group will contain functions dealing with groups, and selection will contain functions dealing with selection. Now we can define our two functions. Notice that we don't have to be as descriptive with our function names. Earlier we called one of our functions createGroup. Since it's now in the group module, and since every Python module is its own namespace, we can just call it create. When it's used, it'll be addressed as group.create. Now, from MotionBuilder, we can import these modules directly and use the functions that they provide. And with everything set up, we can easily add more functions. Here's one that lists all the selected components, not just models. We'll call it selection.list. That is, it lists the current selection. But you'll notice now that if we try to use this new function, Python doesn't recognize it. That's because it wasn't defined when Python first loaded the module. To force Python to import the module again, we can use the built-in reload function. It's helpful to keep these reload calls in place while you're writing the library, but it's not a bad idea to remove them from production code. Finally, to make our library easier to work with, we can make our submodules accessible from the main package, so that we only ever have to import a single module. To do this, we can modify the init file for our package. Now when we write our client code, we can simply import our package and keep everything contained in the MB namespace. And that's how to create a Python module. Thanks for bearing with me. I know this isn't directly related to MotionBuilder, but I couldn't pass up the opportunity to stand on a soapbox, and I want to make sure that we're all on the same page. In upcoming videos, I'll be showing some utility functions and waving my hand at the details of where they are and how they work, so I figured I should explain up front. And at any rate, I hope you've learned something about how to write well-organized code. Thanks for watching.